Well, now most of the speakers have already told many things about the consents in medical practice. Now we'll go specifically with certain consents in the orthopedics, and there may be some repeating as though the previous speakers. Well, when one cannot see ahead without looking at the past, because all my this talk has come from the specific you can say judgments of the previous courts in which the doctors were implicated, and they were not aware that this can be a clause for as a medical negligence. So because there is nothing like there is no book what should be the ideal consent or something, so all this talk is from the previous experience of the all the previous judgments. So what is medical negligence? Because the consent is there so that we are not proved to be a medical negligence. A documentary medical negligence, I'll put it as a surgical medical negligence is different and all others are different, but documentary medical negligence is there, and there is what the consent and the documentation comes. So that is the wrongful actions or the omissions of professionals in the field of medicine in pursuit of their profession while dealing with the patient. We are masters in the field of orthopedic, but with that, a basic knowledge of how judicial forum deals with the cases relating to the medical negligence is also absolutely necessary for the doctor. And the need for such knowledge is more than before in the light of the higher premium or compensation being placed by the Indian forums on the value of the human life and suffering. The doctors have been penalized for as much as 11 crore rupees. So what judiciary seeks actually? Judicial forums, while seeking to identify wrongdoers and the wrongdoing in the case of medical negligence, actually, they aim at striking a careful balance between the autonomy of a doctor to make the judgments and the rights of the patient to be dealt with them fairly. Except they expect the only minimum standard below which the patient cannot be dealt with. Judicial forums have also signaled an increase in need of the doctors to engage with the patient during treatment. This is the most important. The doctors don't spend, especially doctors in the institutions are very busy doctors or highly senior doctors. They spend much less time with the patient as far as counseling is concerned. And then there is a misunderstanding and the problem arises. Especially when the line of the treatment is contested, when there are alternative lines which are available, or when the particular line of treatment can have a serious side effects and the alternative treatment, they do exist. So in the process of judgment, the judicial forums tend to give sufficient leeway to doctors, and they expressly recognize one, complexity of the human body, inexactness of the medical science, it's not a perfect one still. It is evolving and is going to change a lot in future. Third is inherent subjectivity of the process. Fourth is the genuine scope for the error of judgment from the doctors, and the importance of the autonomy of the doctor, which he can take a decision at the 11th hour. The law does not prescribe the limits of the high standards that can be adopted, because they can be different at different places. In metro, they will be different. In cities, they will be different. In peripheral area, they will be different. But what is most important, what they see is impeccable documentation and flawless consent. Now, what is consent? Consent is, as I said, it is a contract. It is an important document to protect a medical practitioner from liability for harm to the patient which can arise out of the procedure. Consent occurs when one person voluntarily agrees to the proposal or the desires of the another, that is here the patient and doctor. There are many types of the consent, which include implied, express, informed consent, unanimous consent, and digital consent. But in medical field, what we see only is now is implied consent, and there is going to be a big talk after this for the digital consent. Now, before the patient can be a binding consent, the doctor must explain the significant risk or the procedure or the medication which might change the patient's mind about whether or not to proceed with the treatment. If the doctor does not explain any risk which can subsequently occur, then that is considered negligence. So after giving all available information, we should allow the patient to decide whether they are ready to take the risk involved in that particular procedure. It has to be another part is the consent has to be in the patient's mother tongue and in the language which is comprehensible to him. Now, in the past, we were taking just a small consent or a few lines consent, but now the time has come to have 3 to 4 pages consent rather than a short one. The reality is that orthopedic surgeons routinely obtain informed consent prior to surgery. It is there. Now, almost everybody takes the consent, but they don't give much importance or they don't spend time as they are already engrossed in other, especially nursing home owners have to see so many things. And so there is a practice to have blanket printed form. When some associations have printed, local associations have printed that printed form, and you have to just fill in the blank. But some take signature only on the blank paper, especially in periphery, they just take a signature. And that is actually not a good one. That it can be a criminal one also. Another part is sometimes there are no witnesses at all, or patient signature is not taken. Rather, we were not also taking patient signature till last 6-7 years. Practice for almost 36 years, because we were thinking that the patient is not in the same state of the mind to give the consent. But now there was one judgment which has gone against only because the patient signature was not taken. Since then, we have started taking patient signature. There are, of course, certain exceptions to that. Then, taking consent just before the surgery, patients and relatives are in a different state of the mind just before surgery. And if you give them consent just before surgery, then there can be a lot of misunderstandings and so many things. And one of the question was, their relatives said that we had given the consent only when we were under the tension. So those things can come arise. Another part, we have found that the consents are either incomplete or only superficial explanation is there. And all these are legally inadequate consent. Especially when you overwrite something on that or add something into the previous consent which is already signed, then you have to take an additional signature of all the concerned parties who have taken signature before that, because that is again taken as an offense when you change the modify or edit the consent. Now, the required standard of the informed consent should be determined by the state, I will say state means our country. But generally, the three acceptable legal approaches to adequate informed consent are: one, the subjective standard, that is, what would this patient need to know or understand to make an informed decision? Second is reasonable patient standard, that what would be the average patient need to know to be an informed participant in the decision? And lastly, it is a reasonable physician standard. What would a typical physician would do or say about this particular procedure, or would decide the surgery for this particular procedure? Now, there are also certain exceptions to the informed consent, that if the patient is incapacitated, the life-threatening emergencies with inadequate time to obtain the consent, and some very, very rarely this is a voluntary waived consent. This is very rare, but I will say don't go for all these things. If the patient's ability to make the decision is questioned or unclear, an evaluation by a psychiatrist to determine the competency may be requested. If you see a patient not in a state or in a mind state, then this is required. A situation may arise in which a patient cannot make decisions independently and has not designated any decision maker. So in this instance, of the hierarchy of the decision makers, which is determined by each country's laws, must be sought, and it is better to determine the next legal heir into that. And lastly, if that situation is there, it is better to, and the surgery is not an emergency one, it is better to call a police and take the consent in front of them. Now, the how should you format? These formats are important, rather that is the main crux of the subject. There has to be a name of the hospital with the logo. If it is a singly owned hospital, they're better to have a name of the doctor with MCI recognized degree. Don't put the degrees which are not recognized by the MCI, that then you can be in a problem because the lawyers, they try to find out such lacune in your document. Another part is better to have local authority registration number of the hospital, because there are certain hospitals which are not registered with the local authority. It's not like having a license. And if you are doing a practice in an unlicensed hospital, that can be taken as an negligence or the offense. Then all details of the patient, not only just name, the full name, age, preferably date of birth is important. Then the sex, address with the proof, identification mark, which will require sometimes during certificate, and some ID proof, especially for the foreign nationals, the Aadhaar card number and the passport number. And of course, the patient's hospital registration number has to be there. Then the name of the operation in the detail, the side of the limb and the exact area, tibia, femur, something like this. And what is the indication for the procedure, or what is the diagnosis of procedure? Suppose you are doing either BMAC or the stem cell for the vascular necrosis of the femoral head, that has to be mentioned there. And sometimes the procedure has to be written in a few sentences. And rarely you require the detailed procedure, because there are certain patients, one in out of 100, especially in Pune area, which is everybody knows what kind of the Puneri person is there. And there sometimes you have to write down everything in detail, because he already has read the Google and he knows all many things. And sometimes he said, instead of doing this, what you have done, then that. If you find such exceptional person, you can write down the surgical procedure in detail beforehand. These are the things which I am going to do. Then name of the primary surgeon and his qualified assistants also you can put, and their degrees, and mention whether they are allopathic or Ayush, because there is another point of contention. So there are, in the future also, the Ayush orthopedic surgeons are likely to come already. The curriculum probably has been started. And better to register the registration number, that you are registered medical practitioner. This problem can arise if you are practicing at one state and you are registered in another state. This particular point can be taken by the lawyer of the other part. So it is better to write the registration number of the state. And those doctors who call visiting doctors to operate, it is better to have a disclaimer that to write there, please be aware that a surgeon other than the consultant, but with the adequate training and supervision, is likely to perform, is going to perform your operation. Then about the alternative measures or alternative procedures which other than what you have decided. So describe the names of the all alternatives, including the non-operative management, that these are alternatives which are available. In short, explain the pros and cons of all these procedures. What is the advantage and what is the disadvantage and why I'm choosing this particular procedure? Most of the time, it is better that patient should choose the procedure. And you can mention at the end that some of the above are not appropriate if I want to regain as much physical activity as possible. But I have discussed all the possibility from my with my detaining doctor. That's a disclaimer. It's better to have that. Then another part is about the implants. Now, first, we have to see what are the implants which are available in your area, because all implants may not be available at the remote place or in the peripheral area. So you have to explain to the patient that these are implants which are available in our area. Then there are variations in implants, a lot of variation in implant. So you should better tell, generally I spend half an hour to 1 hour with the patient for TKR in the spine or even of certain, I call them medical pro patients, because you have to explain them everything, that what are the disadvantages and advantages of every implant. For example, for a fracture fixation, whether you're going to Indian implant or the imported implant, or these are available and let the patient choose out of those things. Or whether there's stainless steel implant, there are titanium implants also. For the knee replacement, you have to tell them whether there is a gold knee which is available, oxygenium and poly is also available. And you know there are a lot of variety for the hip arthroplasty implants, either they are cemented or the non-cemented. There is a ceramic, ceramic on poly, metal on metal, metal on poly. You have to explain everything, and that's a positive and negative disadvantage. In other areas also like arthroscopy, what kind of the internal fixation you are going to do. If you want to use a screw, whether it is a SS screw, titanium screw or the Epsilon screw, either in the shoulder or in the knee joint. Then even sometimes it is better to write what immobilization material you are going to use. You give the idea, POP has such advantage, disadvantage, and fiberglass is also there. Then what color of the, sometimes we ask the patient the color, because one of the patient argued a lot. You didn't tell me what are the variety of color available. You have put this particular color of fiberglass cast and I wanted that cast now. You know, so it is better that you tell in the beginning. And here is the important, when this all menu card has been given to the patient, let the patient and his relative choose the implant as well as the material, what can be used for that. Afterwards also, you have to tell them about what is the duration of partial or the total non-weight bearing. Yeah. Then about the risk, you have to explain everything about the risk and the possible complications which are there. As with all the procedure, this is a sentence which has to be there every time. This surgery or this procedure also carries some risk and complications. Now, these complications can be because of the anesthesia and or because of the procedure or the orthopedic procedure itself. Then another part, you should write the intraoperative. There can be complications postoperative or even the some complications are delayed one. And where we can write what are the common complications which occur in the 2.2 to 5% of the patients. It's better to write the percentage also and detail the little bit two or three sentences about that particular complication, which I'll show you in the sample. Then there are certain less common complications and the rare complications. Some of the doctors have been held guilty because they have not written that rare complication which has occurred there. And that particular complication has occurred in that particular patient. And this is there with every patient. Even there is a removal of implant also, we take this complication that death can occur during anesthesia, during surgery and post-operative period, because we have seen the patients dying just during anesthesia without even starting the procedure, and even a small like a tonsillectomy and appendectomy, they have been dead. Then now the surgical complications. In the intraoperative, it is best to matter, just take a textbook in front of you and mention all the possible complications which are there in the textbook for that particular procedure. Generally, they are unexpected and excessive bleeding. Then the fracture can occur, especially in the replacement cases, and the neurovascular injury during surgery, and in cement complications, again, where you are using the cement, that can happen intraoperatively. Then about the postoperative complications, it's better to write the stiffness, non-union, mal-union, deformities, and patient rare can have a metal and the plastic allergy. Now, removal of the implant. We have to tell them in the beginning, apne pehle nahi pata hai ki implant remove karna padta hai. That's the allegations later on we can get. So you have to tell them, and some of the patients expect the removal of implant in the same cost as that of the previous surgery, that we have to pay additional money for removal of implant. That's what they ask later on. So you have to tell them that this is an additional surgery and with additional expenditure. And there are certain reasons of the removal. It's not necessary that every implant has to be removed. But suppose the fracture is united and it may cause problem in future, we have to remove. Or sometimes there is a pain during the change of weather in a cloudy season or in the rainy season, patient can get a pain. And rarely, in the VIP areas and airport, when there is security check, the sometimes the sound of the metal can come and they can have a lot of problem. So those patients have removed their implant. Implant removal is sometimes required for the complication. All this has to be mentioned, that breakage, loosening, migration, especially for the KYRs. KY have migrated from one place to another, even they have gone into abdomen also, and allergic reaction to those implants. Now there are another part which has to be there is anesthesia complications. You have to mention what is the type of anesthesia you are going to give, and in short explanation, what is exactly spinal anesthesia, what is epidural one, and different blocks if you are using for the upper extremity or even for lower extremity. Then what are the alternatives also available apart from this? There are some patients who are very much scared. No, don't give me spinal anesthesia. I just want to remain unconscious, so give me general anesthesia. And sometimes it is vice versa. And additionally, you have to mention that it and all, sometimes you have to change to the GA yourself, because this epidural action has not come up, the supraclavicular action block, has the action has not come up. Then you have to mention the name of the degree. Now these are the complications. In Pune, one of the doctors, there was a patient died during the close reduction of a elbow dislocation. And then later on they found that the anesthetist was an Ayush one. Government allows the Ayush practitioner or consultant to practice, but then it has to inform to the patient that this particular anesthetist is allopathic or this particular anesthetist is Ayush. And if he's ready for that, the permanent anesthetist, then you can do that. But it's better to now mention the degree, because that problem can come in the future. Sometimes in the risky cases, you have to mention that there are second anesthetist available, mention his name, degree, and again same. And it is always better to write the registration number these days for every doctor. Here also we have to mention the same line as that of the surgical procedure, that what are the risks, the complications, the common complications, less common complications, rare complication, that particular anesthesia. We have format of all those things. For a spinal, this is so and so things. For epidural, so and so things. And again, write down the date, because here the complication is the highest for you. And even in the Supreme Court, if the death occurs, especially even if the death doesn't occur and patient goes in the coma, there's a patient becomes a brain dead, that is taken as a negligence of the doctor. Since rare complication can occur from any of the above complication that you have to mention, and same thing, the death can occur during anesthesia, during post-op period, or in the later on also. Now about the additional surgery, sometimes you plan one surgery, but on the table you find that some other surgery is required, as rather abandoning surgery. So chances of the abandoning surgery also can come there because of any reason, like unexpected bleeding or any intraoperative complications. Sometimes you have to abandon that. And sometimes you have to abandon because of non-medical reasons. There are certain accidents during the operation. There is failure or breaking down of equipment. Sometimes rather recently it has happened with the spine surgery, that the C-arm started malfunctioning, and that's why they could not put the screw properly in the pedicle, and they were held responsible for that. And that has happened in the institutions, because the operating surgeon doesn't have any control over that particular management of the C-arm, whether that the servicing contract is there or not, what kind of AMC is there. A surgeon cannot have, but the judiciary has held them responsible. So that it is better to have it into the consent, especially during arthroscopy. Sometimes suddenly light sword doesn't work, or sometimes the shaver doesn't work and you are in the soup. Or rarely the scope can get broken, and then you have to abandon the surgery. Apart from that, the machinery is also, hospital machine like genset is, the light has gone, but genset is also not working. OT light, OT table, suction machine, anesthesia workstation, they can go out of order anytime even when there is a servicing contract. And lastly, any mishap which is occurring to operating surgeon himself, if he becomes unconscious or something happens to him, that surgery needs to be abandoned. Another part is the shifting of the patient, the possibility of injuring advertently during the transfer to the wards. This has happened in one of the cases. The patient surgery was done, everything was done good, and the patient was shifted from table to the trolley. The patient fell down, and she had a serious injury. It was a post seizure, and she bled inside, and rather she died because of that. Then another possibility as keeping the patient in the ICU in case of the certain unexpected complications, and we have to explain them in the beginning that there are chances of increasing the bill if the patient goes to ICU, as Dr. Mishra just said, that they can charge us for the excessive bills, but it is better to mention that if any further complication will require the additional bills. Third thing is about the possibility of shifting, especially for the nursing homes, that this for every patient this has to be written. There is a possibility of shifting the patient to the higher centers in case of the unexpected complication or the situation. And lastly, again, a disclaimer sort of that to the patient, that if you have any complaints about your treatment or your care, you are always encouraged to discuss with us and our surgical team. That you have to mention at the end, because later on he can say, after 2 years or 3 years, you have not told me so and so things. And lastly is this, this, I have read and understood the procedure and the risk and the complication. I have asked any questions and raised my immediate concern I might have. I understand another surgeon. Lastly, the confirmation. I understand another surgeon other than my consultant may perform this operation, although they will have adequate training and supervision. I understand that I will have opportunity to discuss the details of the anesthesia with an anesthetist before the procedure. And I understand that any procedure in addition to those described on this form will only be carried out if it is necessary to save my life or to prevent serious harm to my health. It's always better to, because only one, if you forget to write only one thing, and if the patient gets that, you will be in the soup. Lastly, at the end of the consent, it is better to have a signature of the patient also, as well as for the witnesses, and better to have the witnesses as their close relatives. Better not to take it from the friend, because it has happened in one of the doctor that there was a PID with a paraplegia, and the business partner has signed it, and later on when he found that his paraplegia is not recovering, he alleged that the partner and the doctor has conjunction they did the mischief, and these things have happened. So it is better to have close relatives with them. Of course, the date and the time has to be there. What we advise these days now, you don't give the consent at the 11th hour, because that was happening in the past. In the scheduled cases or in the cases which are not emergency, you can give the first, take the consent from the patient that I have received this particular consent form. And just before surgery also, you can have second confirmation that I have read everything and I agree to that, because it can happen. Again, that we have much lesser time was given to us. We were under tension, and so we signed and we were not knowing what is there, because our consent was taken when the patient was just to be taken in the operation theater. So another part is the name of the surgeon. It's better to have capital letters, degree and the registration number, especially in the institutes, the signature of the surgeon, and better to have a designation of that particular surgeon if he's not a single nursing home owner, either they are in the multi-speciality or the single speciality having the multi-doctor hospitals. At the end of the consent. Now, other consents are also better to have if you are doing those things that in national registry now. Say, for example, if the joint replacement registry has been kept or the arthroscopy registry has been kept, it is better to write the name of that registry and the email and special consent, which I wrote here specifically, that I have read and comprehended the patient information leaflet and consent to my personal details being submitted to the national joint registry in the knowledge that they will only be disclosed in the public interest or in other circumstances permitted by law. I have been assured and understand that by declining my consent, my care and treatment will not be affected in any way. So this is better to have this particular consent in case those institutions who are informing the cases to the national registry. Now I will give certain samples of how the thing should be there. In say example for in THR, can you see this?
Yes.
Yeah. So it is there that at the top there has to be the logo of the hospital and the name of the hospital.
No, the format is not
visible. Format is not seen. I'll just see what is there in the share it again. Now is it seen?
Yes.
Yeah. So as I showed here at the top, there is the name of the hospital and the logo. Then full name, Aadhaar card, those things are there. Now, here an operation, I have given for a THR, or you can say bipolar also. So what, either it is a it is a partially parthoplasty or totally parthoplasty. Then it's short. Now, this is written in the short, but I have got another concern where then they tell the procedure is written in their language, which they will understand that this is a ball and socket, hip joint, very important joint, allows great deal of movement, all those things are there. And hip replacement is an operation which replaces severely damaged hip bone with artificial ball and socket that doesn't function like a natural joint, that does function of the natural joint. It may reduce the pain in help in walking and sleeping. And again, same thing, that all the visiting surgeon is there, it is better to write this particular disclaimer. And you have to explain all these alternative procedures which are there for the patients. That total hip replacement are usually performed on patients suffering from severe arthritis. It is better not to write the age also for those patients. And other alternative methods you have to write here. And then you can mention that some of the above are appropriate if you want to regain as much physical activity as possible. You should discuss the possibility with your surgeons. Now, the next is about the risk. As with all procedures, this carries some risk and complication is the common sentence. And here you can add the little bit detail of the blood clot or the DVT, which is a very common complication which can occur. Then about the bleeding in the surgery. Then about the pain, which is there. The hip will be sore after operation. In their own language, it has to be there, not in our medical language. then the process wear and loosening, then the altered leg length, that is important, especially in the hip surgery, because the, you know, Western countries, even if there is a little bit shortening, they have sued the doctors and court admits that as a rather negligence from the doctor. Then about joint dislocation, then less common complications are infection. Of course, we can put that in the common complication also sometimes, and it is written as 1 or 2% there. And what are these infection? How we deal with that? Then rare complication like altered wound healing or the nerve damage, which is there, or the altered bone damage is there, like a fracture during the surgery, blood vessel damage, it can happen rarely for the when you are putting the anti-retractor, and this pulmonary embolism, which can occur there, which comes in the DVT, as well as DVT is a little bit in the lower limb, then second complication goes is the pulmonary embolism. Sometimes pulmonary embolism also we know that can occur without the DVT. And lastly, this, as I said, this is common in everywhere, that this rare complication can occur from any of our complication. The patient can die during anesthesia, during surgery, or even in the post-operative period. Rather, my patient, one of my bilateral knee replacement patient has died when he has paid all the bill and he was going out of the hospital. So it can happen. One of the patient had died in the assistant itself when he was discharged. So it can happen at any time that you have to write. Then lastly, the confirmation of all this consent. Again, all the confirmation which I read just before that, signature, print name. And this is what I say about the printed. Now, this is not a blanket format. See, when you print the consents from the printing press, and then you're filling the in the blanks with your hand, that can be taken as a blanket printed form. What we do is, these are all computer format. So we type the name of the patient and everything was relevant to the patient there. When a printout comes, the name of the patient is on his disease, everything is printed there. So it acts as a specific form that for particular specific patient. And so court may not take the action against it. The explanation was given before that about the printed consent form, but there are a lot of disturbance among the doctors because of that, because most of them are using just that printed form from the printing press and filling the blanks. And again, second confirmation that I said, that it's better to write there. And lastly, the name of the surgeon and signature of the surgeon. So this is as far as the TDHR without detailed explanation. That, and with detail also, it is something different. And one part is about this, about the implant now. Now, second is about the DHS. Now, about the DHS, there is a fracture patient. Sorry. Now, this same, most of the part is same. Then operation dynamic hip screw, the DHS, or you can try to PFN. You are doing it now. Same thing, alternative, what are the alternative procedures which are available? Now, here you can write DHS there, DCS is there, you know, IPFN is there, or sometimes even some people go for the joint replacements also for that. So that we have to write, it is a community fracture and we are going for joint replacement. And additional procedure here, I have to mention that patient may require sometimes the bone grafting, if at all it is required in the comminuted patient. Again, same thing about the risk, blood clot, bleeding, pain, infection. Sometimes it is better to have a catheterization, written catheterization. If you have difficulty in passing urine immediately after surgery, you may require catheterization, you know, like that. Then there are certain rare complications. Again, said the hip stiffness is there, or avian is there. That doesn't occur in gigantic fractures, non-cervical fractures, but that has to be mentioned there. That is a rare complication which can occur. Then but the remaining is almost the same, and all things are the same. This, as far as the DHS are concerned. And lastly, I will just show you one of the, for the femoral nailing or the internal fixation in the femur. Same thing. What are the intermediate nails which are available? Here you can put about the implants also. I have been explained everything about the different types of the implants, and I am choosing so and so implant that you have to mention there. Again, the procedure in the short. And then here my procedure is in link for those patients, because in Pune we find at least 20% patients who are asking so much details that it is better to write down everything into that. Then there are alternative procedures. What are the procedures which are available, right from the conservative management to the plating and all other things, that it is better to explain him. Again, the risk of the risk is a particular procedures, common risk, less common risk, and catheterization is there. We are writing for also all the lower limb patients, sometimes it is required. And the rare complication here, now in femur, generally compartment syndrome doesn't occur, but I have seen one patient of compartment syndrome of the thigh after a crushing injury. But for the tibia, for everything rather, I have seen a compartment syndrome in the humerus after humerus nailing. So compartment syndrome can occur in all the long bones, that we have to understand, especially the tibia, femur, and rarely the humerus. Then about the if you are doing this failed reduction, it is better to not write the failed. You can say the sort of non-anatomical reduction which is acceptable to the patient. Then this another part, if you are using the tourniquet, the damage to the skin under the tourniquet, that is better to pick this, because some of the patients can get a little bit darkening at the site of the tourniquet, or you can say soreness at the site of the urinary after some time. Then, as I said about the removal of the implant, that consent has to be there. And delayed and non-union consent, it's better to have that consent everywhere, and always have an additional consent of the bone grafting for every patient, because sometimes the fracture is transverse, but then during your nailing, sometimes close nailing is done and that part can get shattered, and you may have to resort to the primary bone grafting, but that has to be mentioned before that. Remaining remains the same. So, take-home message is, now the situation had changed drastically, because we, in the first 20 years of our practice, we didn't have any problem whatsoever. Is that once or twice, once in a blue moon, there was a troubling patient, but we used to tell them, go to the court now. If you are not satisfied with us, you are telling him, but now we are not telling him to go to the court, because court is not as lenient as that it is in the past. So anybody can get into the medical legal problem anytime with anybody. Even your close friends, your relatives also can sue you in the court. So don't give concession to anybody. But my message is that don't worry at all, even in these circumstances, don't get stressed out because of this. First, you accept that this is a part and parcel of our profession. The way you accept that there are certain things that are part and parcel, you accept this also. You be more alert and get everything known as far as the consents part or documentation part is concerned. Start spending more time with the patient if there is a little bit complicated surgery or the troublemakers. Keep all the records. This I am underlying because the most of the doctors, sorry to say, but who come from the government hospital and they come to assist us, they are not at all serious about the documentation and the consent. Rather, some of the doctors have left my job in my hospital because of this reason. And what we are planning now, either IMA or the IOA level, it is better to have approved consent at a national level, because in court of law, you can say that this is the consent we have used, which is approved by our Apex Association in India. Thank you very much.